So thank you very much to Eric and Karen for the invitation, and happy birthday, Dirk. I'm very pleased to give a
Thanks,
talk in
Dominic.
this nice occasion. So I'll share you some joint work with Sylvie Pécha, Kourouche, Johannes Zinger, Yan Cheng Thao, and Jaime Castillo Medina. So, dispatched in several papers during the last 10 years, say. So, okay, I scroll like this, yes. Okay, so I guess most of you know multiple zeta values. So they are given by this iterated sum up there. And the NJs are positive integers, and the first one must be bigger than 2 so that the series converges. And it makes sense slightly beyond that if you have that n1 plus, et cetera, up to nj is strictly bigger than j for any j, you can make sense of this series. So, as you know, the integer k is equal to the depth, and the sum of the arguments is called the weight. Okay? Maybe a little less well known is the multiple zeta function. You can let the arguments go to complex numbers, and then you make sense of the following nested series. Of course, it doesn't converge every time, but the domain of convergence has been settled by these three authors 20 years ago. The series converges provided the real part of the sum of the J first is strictly bigger than J. And more than that, these authors prove that you can extend this in a holomorphic function of, well, so, sorry, you can extend this to a more meromorphic function of k complex variables in the whole C to the k. And it's possible to describe precisely where the singularities are. And they are described here. So the singular locus is cut into homogeneous parts, so to speak, SK. And these are those Z1 up to ZK in C to the K with either Z1 is equal to 1 or Z1 plus Z2 is in this set, or there's a J in 3 up to k, so that z1 up to plus zj is the sum is smaller than j, smaller or equal than j. Okay, here you recognize the fact that the simple zeta function is holomorphic everywhere except at z equal to 1. Here you jump from 2 to 2. It's related to the fact that the Bernoulli numbers with odd rank all vanish except the first one. And from dimension 3, you don't have any gaps like this. Okay, so of course, you probably know quasi-Shuffle relations. Here is an example. If you multiply two simple zeta values, you get a linear combination of double and simple zeta values. And you cut into three parts because you sum over M1 and M2. And so you decide whether M1 is strictly bigger than M2 or converse, or whether you are on the diagonal M1 equal to M2. Okay, this gives you these three terms. Okay, that's possible to write the most general quasi-Shuffle relation, so to speak. So you multiply together two multiple zeta values of depth p and q, respectively, and you get a sum of terms of depth P plus Q minus something, because you can have some so-called contraction terms, and you sum over all the quasi-shuffles, which are surjective maps from 1 up to P plus Q onto 1 up to P plus Q minus the number of contractions. And these surjections are subject to a shuffle-like constraint, sigma 1 strictly smaller than, etc., sigma p, and the same for the second packet. But you can have contraction terms, and in that case, you sum the arguments. And
Dominique,
the
there's
yeah.
a Frederic Chapleton asked in the Q&A. He
Oh yeah.
suggested if you full screened your slides, you might be able to turn
Ah,
up the music in a better way.
okay. Let me see. Okay. Let me try. Just a second. Play l'écran. Is it better? Ah, yeah. Okay. Merci, Frédéric. Okay, so let's continue. So much for these quasi-shuffle relations. And of course, you may have to sum maybe two terms, but not more. Okay? Because it can happen that some sigma in the first row is equal to some sigma in the second row. Then you have to sum. Okay. So now there are shuffle relations because of the integral representation. So most of you also know that. You can have a multiple zeta value by means of an iterative integral, and you iterate the same number of integrals as the weight, and you integrate dt1 over t1, and then up to n1 minus 1, and then dtn1 up to over 1 minus tn1, and then you start with the n2, etc. Okay, and then, sorry, from this representation, you have a second way to express the product of two multiple zetas as a linear combination of multiple zetas. These are the shuffle relations. So let me give the canonical example. You multiply zeta of 2 by itself, and then you have to integrate, you have a fourfold integral of this form. And you integrate over a product of simplices. And this product of simplices, you can rearrange it into six different simplices, and it amounts to shuffle two words of with two letters, and you get 4 times zeta of 3 1 plus 2 times zeta of 2 2. And then you have also regularization relations. The first of one was already known by Euler. Zeta of 2 1 is equal to zeta of 3, and you obtain it as follows. Of course, zeta of 1, it doesn't exist, but okay, you say it's something. It's some indeterminate. Zeta of 1 2, it's also divergent, so it's marked in red. And you apply quasi-shuffle relation formally, and also shuffle relations formally. Okay, and then you can equate the two right-hand side terms, and of course these two infinite terms cancel, and you are left with zeta of 3 is equal of zeta of 2 1. Okay. So, of course, there's a big conjecture related to the period conjecture of Kontsevich and Naguier, saying that no other relations occur among multiple zeta values. There has been some steps in that direction. They might look tiny, but they are really crucial. And it was done about 20 years ago by Rivoal and Zudilin after the first pioneering work by Roger Appéri, who proved that zeta of 3 is irrational. Okay, so it's a good point to make some historical remarks. double zeta values were already known by Leonhard Euler, as well as a lot of relations relating double and simple ones. I say almost all because you have some, for example, at weight 12, you have some relations coming from modular forms by Gangl, Kaneko, and Zagier, for example. There was not known in the 18th century. But apart from these very difficult relations, a lot of them were already known. And then there's a gap which is not completely empty. I could cite, for example, works by Nielsen. But then I directly jump to the 80s, and I should mention Jean Eckhall, because up to my knowledge, it is the first place when you can see the multiple zetas in a whole, in a full generality, in Les Fonctions Résurgentes, in a second volume. And then, of course, came these works by Donzaguier, Michael Hoffman, and the integral representation is attributed to Maxim Kontsevich by Donzaguier in his 1994 paper in ICM. And this was the starting point to the modern approach with periods for mixed state motifs. And of course, I must mention the breakthrough by Francis Brown 8 years ago. Now we know that any multiple zeta value is a linear combination with rational coefficient of multiple zeta values with arguments equal to 2 or 3. This was the conjecture by Hoffman. Okay, so very quickly, I mentioned multiple polylogarithms in one variable. So you start with the integral representation of multiple zetas, but instead of integrating from 0 to 1, you stopped at some t between 0 and 1. And quite easy computation can show you that you have also a nested sum representation of these multiple polylogarithms. Okay, but I want to express these polylogarithms in another way. So I introduce these two functions of t, 1 over t and 1 over 1 minus t. And I introduce the operators multiplication by these functions. Okay, big X is multiplication by small x, this map. Big Y is multiplication by small y. And the operator R is the integral, the primitive operator. Okay, this is well known. It is a Rota-Baxter operator of weight 0. And with these three operators, you can define, well, you can find a formula for your polylogarithm. You start with a constant function equal to 1, and you apply to it this row of operators. Okay? And this gives you the polylogarithm. And of course, when your row of integers is a converging row, when you set the variable t to 1, you recover the multiple zeta. Okay. There's the word description. Okay. Maybe you know all this. I'll be quite quick. You look at an alphabet with an infinite number of letters. Y star is the set of words with letters in Y. You look at the linear span. And you define the quasi-shuffle product, which is just an abstract way of rewriting the quasi-shuffle relations. The sum is looking the same. Because on the span of y itself, you have a kind of internal product given by yi multiplied by yj is equal to yi plus j. And then you can define the quasi-shuffle product like this. And for later use, you can also use a shuffle product. This is the same sum, but you stick to r equal to 0. I mean, you stick to ordinary shuffles and you want to discard all the contraction terms. So here is an example of quasi-shuffle product and an example of shuffle product, because here you have these two contraction terms. When you multiply y2 by y3 here, or y2 by y1, okay, you get these two contracted terms, and in the shuffle product, you discard them.
How's it going?
Oh, I keep trying to write my talk, but
Okay.
I'm saying things that I probably should try to understand, but I don't want to.
Okay, so shall I continue? Okay, I call convergent words the words which doesn't which don't start with Y1, and for me zeta quasi shuffle of word is just zeta of the corresponding arguments. But then you can extend zeta quasi shuffle linearly and applying to a linear combination of words. And the quasi-shuffle relations are just summed up by this relation here. Okay, so here is an example. So this is the ordinary way of writing the quasi-shuffle relation, and this is the word way. You can see the correspondence. I go to the work with to give a meaning to this sum, and we succeeded, but just looking at the quasi-shuffle relations. So what is about exactly? We can find the character of this algebra Q of Z equipped with the quasi-shuffle product with values in the complex number. And Q of Z is the span of words with letters in Z. Okay, reflecting that I also want non-positive arguments in my extending multiple zeta values. Okay, so there exists a character so that phi of v is equal to zeta quasi shuffle of v for any convergent word, converging word. And also, sorry, if you take a word so that zeta of n1 up to nk can be defined by analytic continuation, then I want that the value of the character coincides with this analytically continued value. So in particular, phi of minus 1 minus n is equal to the known value for zeta of minus n. And for in depth 2, you have also some values which can be reached by analytic continuation, and our character coincides with this. So here is the table we obtained in depth 2. So you can see, for example, some diagonals. Some diagonals, they have the same argument everywhere except at the upper right corner. These diagonals are values obtained by analytic continuation. This one also, etc. The other diagonals, they are not obtained that way. And for example, there's a work by Li Guo and Bin Chang, which was published a little bit before us. And the table of values is different. But of course, the values obtained by analytic continuation, they are the same, fortunately. But I'll go back to the fact that there's no uniqueness for this problem. Okay. So maybe I'll skip the sketch of proof because time is running. But yeah, just a few words. We first go to regularization. That means that we were able to obtain a character with value, with values in the meromorphic functions. This was not so trivial to prove that this intermediate character, this regularized character, takes values in the meromorphic functions. It has to respect quasi-shuffle and not shuffle. That's why we have to twist with the so-called Hoffman exponential. But all this works. And then we use the Birkhoff-Kohn-Kreimer decomposition of our character with values in the meromorphic functions. We use minimal subtraction scheme. And then we evaluate the positive part at z equal to zero. So this is a quick reminder of the Birkhoff-Kohn-Kreimer decomposition. You can write your character like this as a convolution product of two characters. Phi plus takes values in the functions which are holomorphic at zero. And this one basically takes values in the pole part. And there are recursive formulas for these two characters, phi minus and phi plus. For phi minus, you project this red expression on the pole part, and this is the Bogoliubov's preparation map. And the same expression, if you project on the other part, on the positive part, you get the positive character phi plus. And now here is the definition of our normalized multiple zeta values. You evaluate phi plus at z equal to zero. Okay, so now we have one solution. We even have a one parameter family of solution because you can decide what zeta of one is, for example. But now we want to describe all solutions to the problem. The problem was to find multiple zeta values at any argument of any sign so that the quasi-shuffle relations are still verified. Okay, so this is our work with Kourouche and Johannes Zinger. And there's a renormalization group behind all this. So you can start with any commutative connected filtered Hopf algebra. And you look at a commutative unital K algebra, and you look at the group of characters of H with values in A. The product is given by convolution. And here is our first result. You look at the right co-ideal with respect to the reduced co-product. Okay, so you want that delta tilde of n is included in n tensor H. And the co-unit applied to n is equal to zero. Then this set is a subgroup of the group of character. So this set is the set of the characters which vanish on this right co-ideal. And this is a subgroup of the group of character. So here is the proof. It's not very complicated. You just take alpha and beta in TA. You want that alpha multiplied by beta inverse. Is still in TA, so you compute this on an element of the co-ideal, and you want to find zero. So you say that okay, beta minus one is given by composing with the antipode. So now you display what is convolution. Okay, this is Swidler's style notation, and then you replace the antipode by its recursive expression here. Okay, and then you can compare this term with that one here, and you recover alpha of W minus beta of W plus a sum of alpha minus beta of W prime. And because N is the right co-ideal, these terms here vanish, and the whole sum above vanishes, and you are done. Okay? So we call it the renormalization group associated to the co-ideal N. And now we look at zeta. For us, for the moment, it's a partially defined character. That means that it sends one on one, and it's multiplicative whenever each term is defined. Okay, and you look at psi zeta a is equal to those phis in the group of characters, so that phi restricted to the co-ideal is equal to zeta. And we showed that it's a principal homogeneous space on the renormalization group TA. So we have a free transitive action. And the proof is, okay, I'll skip it, but it's quite the same than the proof that TA was a subgroup. Okay. So now we apply that to our special case. The base field will be the field of rationals. Our Hopf algebra is Q of Z star, where Z is the alphabet on relative integers. And the target algebra will be just the complex numbers. And the right co-ideal is the linear span of so-called non-singular words. That means words y is equal to, w is equal yn1 up to ynk is in big N if and only if n1 is different from 1, n1 plus m2 is not in this set, and you have this third condition in depth bigger than 3. So there are the conditions opposite to the definition of the singular locus. So these are called non-singular words. And if you think a little bit about it, big N is the right co-ideal for the deconcatenation coproduct. What matters is the left part of the decomposition, if you want. And moreover, it is stable by contractions. So sigma will be the complementary, the set of singular words. And it's related to the singular locus of the beginning. Okay. And now our partially defined character zeta will be the multiple zeta value whenever it exists, either by direct convergent or by analytic continuation. And now we can say that the set of all solutions to our initial problem is given by x zeta c is equal to the renormalization group acting on a particular solution. Unfortunately, we know that a particular solution exists. Okay. And what else? Not so much, apart that we are convinced that this group is very big. At least it's infinite dimensional. Okay. So to speak, we have renormalized the quasi-Schoeffer relation. What about the Schoeffer relations? Of course, it's a more delicate question because Schoeffer relations, if you go to the negative side, that means that you have to shuffle two packets of cards with a negative number of cards, which doesn't make so much sense. So fortunately, by going to Q analogs, we can have a reasonable glimpse on this. So I start with the Jackson integral, everybody knows. here I have illustrated it in with two values of q equal to 1/2 and q equal to 3/4. And you can see that if q goes to 1, your Jackson integral goes to the ordinary Riemann integral. Okay. But the parameter q, you can consider it as an indeterminate. And it becomes the Jackson integral operator becomes an endomorphism of this algebra, tq of tq, the formal series with two indeterminates. Okay. I will need a weight minus one Rota-Baxter operator given by pq. So it is f of t minus plus f of qt plus f of q square t, etc. Okay, and here in our algebra A, it's invertible, and the inverse is given by dq, defined by dq f of t is equal to f of t minus f of qt. So we have a modified Leibniz rule, which it's just comes from the weight minus one Rota-Baxter operator, Rota-Baxter identity, sorry. And we have three identities which are equivalent because PQ is the inverse of DQ. Okay. So now I define multiple polylogarithms with parameter Q. So I recall the definition of the ordinary multiple polylogarithm. If you replace the Riemann integral operator by the Jackson integral operator, you get your Q multiple polylogarithm. Okay, so for later use, I also need a y bar of t, which is equal to t over 1 minus t. And a big y bar will be the operator of multiplication by this function. And here comes the Ono, Okuda, Zudilin model for Q multiple zeta values. So here is the definition. You evaluate the Q multiple polylogarithm at Q. And explicitly, this gives you this ZQ of N1 up to NK. This is also a nested sum, but you use Q to the M1 on the numerator. And you use quantum integers at the denominators. Okay. Of course, when Q goes to 1, in a reasonable way, you recover your ordinary multiple zeta values when the world converges. You can also express them in terms of the operator y bar. Sorry, maybe I skipped something. Ah, yes, okay. You see, we have ZQs and we have ZQ bars. Okay, this is just a normalization of my multiple zetas by the 1 minus q up to minus the weight. Okay. And this modified Q multiple zetas can be expressed in terms of the operators PQ and operator Y bar. Okay. Other models for Q multiple zeta values exist. The Schlesinger model. You evaluate your Q multiple polylogarithm at one and not at Q. The Chao-Bradley model, like this. And also the Bachmann-Kuhn model with multiple divisor functions. And now Henrik Bachmann and Ulf Kuhn have developed a model-free approach of all these Q multiple zeta values, which is very nice, but I have no time to develop this. I'll stick to the Ono, Okuda, Zudilin model. Okay, because this model is interesting because you can extend to arguments of any sign. It still makes sense that you have an estimate here. I mean, for us now, Q will be a complex number of modulus strictly smaller than one. And for any argument of any sign, this formula for your modified commultiple zeta still makes sense, provided you stick to the fact that the inverse of PQ is equal to DQ. Yeah. Okay. So here are some examples with argument zero or minus one, for example. And with Kourouche and Jaime Castillo Medina, we were able to describe double Q shuffle relations. And just before us, Yoshihiro Takeyama did this in the Bradley model, but only in the positive side, and the expression is more complicated in this model. Okay, so first of all, the Q shuffle relations, we need an alphabet with three letters, but with D is equal to the inverse of P. So a non-empty word with these letters writes uniquely like this, with positive or negative powers of P. And this is the definition of the shuffle zeta, shuffle Q zeta, in a word description. Okay, so now by abstracting the relation we had here, I define a shuffle product on these words. And we prove that it's commutative and associative. And the Q shuffle relations can be written like this. The product of two Q multiple zetas is the Q multiple zeta of the shuffle in that sense of two words. Okay. We have also Q quasi shuffle relations. So this quasi shuffle product here can be deduced from the ordinary quasi shuffle product by a kind of translation operator like this. And at the end of the day, you have Q quasi shuffle relations like this. And by for example, if you have two letters, you have the three ordinary quasi shuffle terms plus three other terms with a weight drop. Okay, the weight is not conserved. But if you look at the non-modified Q multiple zetas, you have these six terms, but the weight drop terms have one minus Q in front. So when Q goes to one, you end up with the ordinary quasi-shuffle relations, which is not a surprise, of course. Okay. There are no regularization relations because all this is defined for arguments of any sign, so that's okay, and you just have a change of coding from the quasi-shuffle picture to the shuffle picture. And this is the summary of the situation. You have quasi-shuffle shuffle relations, and that's it. Okay. Let me finish by an example of computation. If I want to multiply zeta q of 1 with zeta q of 2. So with q quasi-shuffle, I have my six terms, the three ordinary terms and the three weight drop terms. With the Q shuffle, I translate it into words, and then I use the shuffle relations in that sense. So you have to play with these rules here. And at the end of the day, you have this linear combination of words. So you get this sum of the four terms. Okay. So now I have to compare this result with the result above. And you will have quite a lot of cancellations. And you end up with this. So it looks like very much the Euler's relation plus a weight drop term. This is more apparent in the non-modified setting. And interestingly enough, of course, you recover Euler's relation when Q goes to 1. And this was already settled in the 30s by Bailey. We thank Vadim Zudilin for having pointed this to us. And Bailey, in this article, attributes this identity to Bell. And it was learned to him by Hardy. So it's quite interesting. But now we have an algebraic framework for this. Okay, so some open problems. It would be interesting to find out other relations. Maybe there are some other relations among Q multiple zetas than a double shuffle. We don't know. And most importantly, we would like to find a compatible coproduct because, okay, this parameter Q yields a natural regularization of your multiple zeta values. And you have a double shuffle picture, which is very nice. But when Q goes to 1, in general, all this explodes, unless your world is convergent. So we would like to have a renormalization machinery. And why not apply the Birkhoff-Kohn-Kreimer renormalization? But for the moment, we didn't succeed because we lack a reasonable coproduct compatible with all this structure. Okay, here are some references. And thank you very much for your attention.
All right. Thank you, Dominique. Are there questions? I see a question in the chat, actually. In the chat, it says, what are the geometric or quantum or arithmetic applications of Q MZT models?
This we don't know. What are the geometric applications? Okay. Is it possible to precise a little bit the question?
Here, I will let the asker unmute and they can ask themselves.
Okay, yeah.
Potentially, anyway.
I think in the chat it was more general, like geometric or quantum or arithmetic applications. So any applications.
So our motivation was, of course, to understand this model, which was rather new at that point. And once we noticed that this model makes sense for arguments of any sign, of course, we wanted to understand that more closely. But for other applications, maybe it would be interesting to go to Q analog of KZ equations. But we have to do that, but we didn't do that yet.
All right, I see David has a question.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dominic, do you have anything to say about the limit Q goes to a root of unity on the unit circle?
Ah, interesting. No, no, but no. that's a very good question. Yeah, but.
think there was a question by Kursh in the chat. Mm-hmm. Could you say a few more words on Henrik and Ulf's model-free approach?
Ooh. As far as I remember, I would have to dive into their work again. I mentioned this bracket notation related to these multiple divisor functions. And they have a more general model with double brackets. And they have a conjecture. Up to my knowledge, it's not solved yet. Their conjecture is that double brackets coincide with simple brackets. You don't create new objects by going to this more general setting. And
So just a comment. I just want to say I saw Henrik Bachmann is among the viewers. So if anybody has questions to Henrik, maybe they can catch him later in the break or so.
I was just going to ask quickly about the stuff that not even from the main part of the talk, but that nice table of rational numbers. I can't resist a nice table of rational numbers. What can you say about interpretations or patterns in those? I mean, clearly I see some factorials in the denominators and things like that, but what can you say about that table?
Okay. It's mostly based on Bernoulli numbers. So for example, in the previous page, you can see the values at these famous nice diagonals. So you can see Bernoulli numbers. In the other diagonals, the formula is more complicated, but you also have sums of products of Bernoulli numbers. So that's why you can see
691
here, all these kind of things.
Henrik can say a word if he wants. I've set him so he can unmute.
Yes. Hi there, Dominic. How are you? Thank you for your talk.
Fine.
So the question, of course, was what about this generalized model? So the idea is just that we take arbitrary polynomials in the numerator and then consider the space spanned by these models. But it turns out that, I mean, you mentioned, for example, this Schlesinger-Sudelin, or you called it Schlesinger model. So it turns out this space is also just spanned by this Schlesinger model if you allow for indices, if you allow them to be zero. Yeah. And then this conjecture, which Dominique mentioned, is equivalent to the statement that this whole space of the Schlesinger model where you allow zero as an index is the same as a space where all entries need to be greater or equal to one. So this is equivalent to the conjecture Dominique mentioned.
Okay.
But yeah, so this generalized idea is just we don't fix a model and just consider the space spanned by these types of Q series, and all these models which were mentioned today are in there.
But in fact, among these models, some do make sense at arguments of any sign and some do not. So that's why we liked very much this model by Sudelin, Ono, and Okuda. But
I mean, you consider somehow an even bigger space when you allow these negative indices, right? So, yeah. I mean, we just consider this positive positive part.
All right. Well, in the interest of time, why don't we all thank Dominique again?